the one of the very challenging thing and interesting topic on VLSI, which is basically the memory cache and compiler design. The main aim of this presentation is basically to give you an insight on what is being done and what are the career growth opportunities in this field. So I hope that I'm able to convey to you at the end of this presentation a more nuanced view of how things are, and hopefully if you are interested in this field, you can look it up further. Okay, can we go to the next slide, please?
Just a minute. So guys, can you see the screen? At least the guys who can hear us.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Can we go to next? Okay. So I know most of you folks are familiar with the memories being used inside. There have been a couple of topics covered, but just in case someone joins, on-chip memories are one of the most important aspect in any design. You always need memories to do to basically store your input data, or when you process data, you need to store that, and then maybe when you output data, also needs to store before you actually send it out, right? So, and obviously, any application, the memory requirements are huge. So, you cannot have all the memory elements in the same place, right? Because it will add to a huge area cost. And in terms of LSI area, also implies how much will be the overall cost of actually designing and manufacturing it, right? So typically memories are organized into levels. You have, I can see right, the levels of cache. There is level 1, level 2 to level n. The higher the level, the farther is away from the processor. So typically when you are actually doing some compute operations, you access the first level of memory for your immediate needs. You expect that whatever data you need for your processing operation or any intermediate data that needs to be stored in the course of the operation, they are actually stored in the level 1 cache, right? I think in the previous presentations you have had introductions to DRAM and non-volatile memories, which form high levels of cache. So today in this presentation we will focus primarily on the level 1 cache design, right, which comprises of the SRAMs bits. You design memories using SRAM bit cells, and that is primarily used for your compute applications. The other graph at the bottom basically shows that obviously since it is a level 1, you expect the data to be available at the shortest possible time, right? So that is why the cost associated with SRAMs is more compared to the higher levels of cache like DRAMs, NVMs, right? And accordingly, their cache time will be more, right? So typically in VLSI, you usually have a memory controllers, which basically controls how data moves between the different levels cache. And in every application, there is, for data access, there is a temporal aspect and there is a spatial aspect, right? So you want, so let's say you're accessing some data, now you might have to access the same amount of data, same data immediately within some period of time, which is basically the temporal aspect. And the spatial aspect is, let's say you are access one set of data, you expect to access similar set of data. So all of them are basically organized close to each other. And the SRAMs basically serve the spatial and temporal aspect of the immediate needs of the processor. Okay. Any question? Okay. Let's move to the next slide. Okay, so here in this slide, we are basically what I'm trying to convey here is basically what are the different kinds of memories we have, right? So we typically, some of them you have already had introduction to previous presentations. So primarily, I'm going to focus on SRAMs and programmable ROMs in course of this presentation. Right. One important thing about on-chip, the level one cache memories are, they occupy humongous amount of space, right? So they occupy more than 50% of the area, and the two-third of device count in more than the two-third in the device count actually in the chip are basically SRAM devices, right? So typically they have the highest density. Right, and that is why optimizing the space that they occupy is extremely important. So what the foundry does to optimize this is, since the actual bit element, which is our memory storage element, consumes the huge amount of space, so they design the memory element using deviated rules. So for the uninitiated, obviously when you have to produce some pattern on the chip, you need to follow certain rules, right? And so you might say that, okay, I can only fabricate a metal of certain width, and they need to be spaced, you know, to minimum distance for be produced, on the chip, right? But since in the memory storage element there are huge number of quantities, and that is a repeatable pattern, so the foundries are able to actually violate those rules and still able to design the memory element. So in that way they are able to achieve a huge amount of density. So at least for the older technology nodes, there sometimes the memory storage elements were designed by design houses using logic rules. But in the lower technology nodes, you want to achieve higher and higher density, all the memory bit cells are actually designed using deviated bit cell rules. So they are actually supplied by foundry, and the design houses actually take those bit cells and use it to design the SRAMs for their applications. Next slide, please. So who are the key players in this industry, right? So as we discussed, so there are the foundries. The biggest foundry now is like sort of TSMC, which designs memories from nodes like 130 nanometer all the way till now 3 nanometer. Then there is Intel, STMicroelectronics, Samsung, Global Foundry. So they have their own fabrication recipe, and for each of those recipes, they come up their own bit cells. So typically the structure remains the same, the way the devices are sized, they remain the same, but obviously there are certain variations depending upon what best is suited for their particular recipe, right? So these are the key players who actually provide or furnish the bit cells at different technology nodes to the different industry on design house or the industry folks, which comprise of the design houses like Intel, Samsung, Nvidia, STMicroelectronics, and other companies who design different products, and they need to design also the memories for the products, right? So they actually source the bit cells from the foundry, design the memories and the product, and then they again they ship it back to the foundry to be fabricated, right? So some of them are have their in-house foundry, Intel, which has its own foundry, and the foundry division provides furniture design or different business units with the bit cells, and they use it to design the edges, right? Apart from that, there are certain third-party memory developers also. They design something called memory compilers. So we will cover the memory compilers in the subsequent slides, but for now, there are companies like ARM, Synopsys, Dolphin Technologies, Invecas. So what these folks do is basically they pick the bit cells from the foundry, they design the memories, and then they pitch their memories to the design houses. So the design houses basically will evaluate the suitability of those memories which can be used for the application or not, and then this is sort of licensed memories from the memory compiler designers, right? And then that after licensing, they actually build their chips using or applications using those memories, and then they again shipped back to the foundry partners to be fabricated, right? So it's basically more like a three-way process. Okay, so for a VLSI person or a person who works on microelectronics and VLSI, there are opportunities to pursue with the foundry partners also, with in terms of bit cell designs, innovative bit cell designs. There are opportunities to pursue with design houses where you work with them to design the memories which are specifically targeted towards their specific applications. Or you can also pursue opportunities with memory compiler designers where you can design general purpose memories which can actually be consumed by various design houses. Next slide, please. So what is, so discuss a lot about memory elements. So what is this memory element, right? So from your elementary circuits, you would have studied about bistable multivibrators. So the bit cells, see, in a very broad sense, if you see, it is nothing but akin to a bistable multivibrator, right? So you want to store, one way or the other. So typical function that it serves is you may want to store some data. So in case you are actually writing into the bit cell and store that data. And at certain point, you want to retrieve that data or the stored data, in which case you will be actually reading from the bit cell. There are multiple variations of the bit cells that are available. The most common one used is basically the 60 single port SRAM bit cell, which has two back-to-back connected inverters, and there are two NMOS pass gates which provide access to the back-to-back connection, right? Obviously, sometimes when you want to actually have higher speed of operation, you would want to do two operations simultaneously. In that case, you have the flexibility to design your memories using 80 dual port bit cell. As you can see, there are two ports to actually access the data to or write data into the bit cell. Also, you can also have some other variations where you have a dedicated write and port as is visible in the 80 dual port bit cell, right? So these, even there can be multiple variations, and different foundries can also provide different types, like to, like you can have 10T or 12T cells, which are suited for some of their applications. And basically the designers can take those bit cells and design as per their needs. But please remember, the bigger the bill, the bigger the area it consumes. So obviously you will be paying a certain amount of area cost if you try to design with a more complicated bit cell, right? So that is the SRAM bit cell. A little bit about the ROM is basically the programmable ROM that is needed for you know, any of your boot application, right? So it typically is a single transistor bit cell, like you have an NMOS which connects basically the bit line to the source line, the VSS, and whether you want to have a zero or one, you actually make the connection of the NMOS with the bit line, or you don't want to make that connection, keep it keep the connection disconnected, that you don't get discharge on the bit line. And accordingly, you can have two states, the bit line discharged, bit line one, or not discharged, which are read as zero and one. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay, so we discussed about memory compiler. So let me now explain what the memory compilers are, right? So typically, when you need memories for your application, right? And they may need it in different sizes. So a memory is typically characterized by the depth or width. So depth specifies what will be the words, and width specifies what will be the bits, right? So you can say, I want this bits, this word, or I want the memory to be in this aspect ratio, right? So there can be different requirements, right? So what the memory compiler does is, it provides you with options. It provides, you have a program where you actually feed in certain fundamental blocks can be arranged together to build a memory in a different configuration. So you can build a memory with different words cross bits combination with different aspect ratios. You can also provide certain options, right? So that is basically a memory compiler, and there are standalone companies who actually design these, right? But the downside of this is basically, since you are trying to come up with some fundamental blocks to actually design a general purpose memory, you can actually hit very high frequencies, or they may not be actually fully suited for all your applications. So typically, if you want to hit an extreme high speed or extreme low voltage and things that where you need a lot of optimizations, these memories not serve your purpose. But for we can say mostly like 85% of applications where your requirements are not that stringent, they can be used, right? But the advantages, basically using these, you can build memories of any particular choice or any particular need within a certain range which they specify, right? But if you have very stringent requirement, then obviously you go the custom memory instances route. So what are these custom memories? So you typically know, okay, for my these applications, I need memories of this capacity. So you go ahead and then you build them and you sort of optimize them, and there's eke out the required power, performance and area, and then design those memories, right? But these are very intensive in terms of effort and costs, right? So if you only go this route, if there is a huge ROI in terms of what the memories will result in your overall performance of the design. Next slide, please. Okay, so a little of the memories for the uninitiated, how the SRAMs work. So typically you have a memory array, which is composed of rows and columns of the fundamental bit cell element, which is the 60, 80 or 10T, whichever you want to select, right? You have a control circuit or a clock generator circuit, which actually generates internal clock. So basically you have an external clock, which comes and generates an internal clock, and then use that internal clock to synchronize all the operations that are required to happen in the memory to be able to complete the read or write operation successfully. So the internal clock generates the word line, which basically initiates a row in which the targeted data is present or targeted data is to be written into, and also the decoders which selects the particular bit cells which are required to be written to or read from in a particular operation, right? So if you look towards your right, I have put a small illustration of how the circuits will look like, right? So since, as I said earlier, the bit cells are typically optimized by the foundry to occupy the least space. If you allow them to do the operation, it will take a huge amount of time, right? Because they don't have a huge amount of drive current. So what happens typically in the read operation is basically you allow the bit cells to develop a certain amount of differential, which is then amplified by the sensAmp, which is also nothing but a back-to-back connected inverter configuration, which sort of amplifies that differential to produce the data, right? So that is a read operation. And in the case of write operation, you actually put the data onto the bitline and the bitline bar, and then turn on the word line to basically activate the bit cell and allow the positive feedback action of the bit cell to kick in to basically write the data in the bit cell. Any questions till this point?
No, sir.
Okay. If not, let's go forward. Next slide, please. Okay, so what are the architectural challenges as a designer? What are the things that you expect you to do when you design memory? One thing is the bit cell selection. As I said, that we have a wide inventory of bit cells available on the foundry for your applications. But it is a designer who knows what is the application that their memory is, what is the requirements of your design, right? Accordingly, you are expected to make a choice on what will be the kind of bit cell that you will use to design your memories. Then there can be the memory architecture analyzation. That is also an extremely important thing. And that is, okay, there's a question, I think, right? So can you come to the question, please? Sorry, I just lost it on the, okay, I'll come back to the questions maybe later. So let me finish this and then we'll get to the question.
Yeah, so I think,
there is something called a memory architectural finalization. So you have the bit cells, and the bit cell, each bit cell have their own characteristics, their susceptibility to noise, their writability. It all depends upon the bit cell design. So there has to be a thorough analysis done before you decide on what kind of memory architecture that you design using that bit cell, or what kind of memory you can design with that bit cell. By that we mean to say, okay, how many, what can be the array size? What can be the key design decisions? So those are all governed by the type of bit cell and the characteristics of bit cell selected, right? Then you have to decide, okay, what is the kind of the speed that I need to hit design? What will be the power consumed the design, right? So all those things will be something that as a design engineer working on SRAMs, you will have to work. Then there are, as we layout challenges, and these have become particularly important as we move down the technology node, where I hope you folks are aware that since we have moved to FinFETs, the layouts have become extremely challenging. The second order effects like well proximity, the shallow trench isolation, STI effects, all those things matter a lot on the device behavior and overall performance, right? So how to do a layout to get the best possible performance, that also becomes very challenging. And then the third one is basically the integration challenges, right? So you design an SRAM memory, but please think of it that it is a part of your overall design, right? So it needs to be able to fit into whatever area is designated for it, it needs to fit. You need to be able to basically hook it up to the periphery, which is designed using standard cells and other blocks, right, which follow a different rules or maybe a different design style, right? So that is extremely important, how best you're able to do it, how best you're able to minimize the forbidden space between that, the transition space from the logic, which you actually call the RLS, to the memories, right? So that handling that also is extremely important. And any design of memories is actually based on three critical parameters that you have to always keep in mind. These are the performance, power, and area. What is the performance you need your memories to hit? What is the area that the memories are expected to occupy? And what is the power, right? It is expected to consume to do its operation. Always, it's a trade-off. You cannot have a memory that is best in performance, best in power, or best in area, right? Because, for example, to give you an instance, if I want a performance, I need my devices to have very high IDSAT so that they're able to switch very fast. So if I want a high IDSAT, I will try to select devices which have low VTs. But if you know that the device's VTs are low, they will leak more. So in terms of power, I will consume more power to hit more performance, right? So there are always trade-offs that will need to be made to do the SRAM design. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so now we come to the roles we see in embedded memory design, right? So I'm talking about it more from a custom memory design perspective. Obviously, certain aspects of it will also apply to compiler design because you need to understand what applications that your memories are going into. But typically important roles that come up is first to start off as either you get in the layout side, you do a layout engineer, or you get into the design engineer side. You start working on first small things like characterization, understand how the memories behave, how the parameters, memory parameters needs to be characterized. And then you move into design aspects of it. Then doing the bits and analysis, taking key design decisions, etc. Those become more of memory designer roles. Apart from that, you also need to have the front-end modeling of the memory. So there is a DF engineer who decides, okay, how to insert the scan chains and what sort of, how do you put the best muxes? How do you have a controllability and observability for the SRAMs? Those kind of decisions are taken by the FE modeling engineer. And at the top sits the architect who actually decides, okay, what is the kind of memory that I want? And how does that memory actually integrate with the overall applications, right? So these are the kinds of roles. There can be some more, finer aspects of roles, or there can be you can always slice and dice. But on a broad aspect, these are the kind of roles that await someone who wants to pursue a career in custom memory design. Next question, next slide, please. Okay, so now you can always ask the question, right? What are the career prospects, right? Because looking at the way things are, right? People want to get into areas where they see a huge growth for some time to come, at least for their professional life, right? So obviously, as long as you do designs, you will always have needs for memories, right? So they are absolutely needed for to meet your data requirements or data handling requirements for all on-chip applications, right? The current challenges are multifold. As you know, that because we are trying to scale using Moore's law, we are sort of hitting the wall now, because we are now sort of from one technology to another technology node, we are just going 2 or 3 nanometer here. And until unless something drastic happens, that it is not going to be accelerated. You're not going to see a huge jump in the technology node as you saw in the past. But apart from that, now folks are trying to branch out into more specific applications. You're looking at some 3D stacking and some other innovative ways in which you want to design memories and get more and more denser memories for your applications. So there are challenges in that direction also. So one is basically as you go down this technology node, how do you design memories? That is an important challenge, and that is going to exist for a certain period of time. Also, you're also trying to look into designing more specialized memories. So it's not only, so memories, now the idea is crystallizing that memory should not only serve the function of just storing data. They should also be able to do some amount of compute applications, because as you know, there are lot many challenges in the AI and ML, right? Where you not only want to have a huge amount of data to work with, but you also want to process the data. So can something of that be taken care of in situ within the SRAM itself, right? So we are thinking of some concepts like memory compute, where along with the storage elements, you are trying to integrate some sort of processing also. So there are very interesting times, at least for the SRAM design. And I mean, as far as I feel, anyone who wants to pursue a career in the SRAM design, there are a lot many challenging opportunities awaiting them in their future. Okay, I think we are at the end of our slide. So I'll be happy to take the questions.
Indranil, can you hear us now? Is your connectivity got improved?
See the questions.
So guys, as Indranil can't hear us, can you type the question on the chat window?
So the first question that I see is, hello, can you hear me, guys?
We can.
Okay. So I think the first question, what I see is it preferable to design a synchronous memory sync design or an asynchronous design, and under what constraints we need to choose them? So obviously, it depends upon what your applications are, right? So typically, you need to choose depending upon, so memories are not designed based on your just give me a second, guys. Memory not designed in isolation, right? So they depend upon your overall chip applications, right? So obviously any applications are basically synced with a clock. So mostly we do a synchronous design, but yeah, there can be some specialized applications where you may have to do asynchronous design. But but in practice, they are mostly synchronous designs. If there will be a webinar on DRAM designing, I think Dhritiman can basically get on that question.
Okay. Yeah, we'll address it separately.
Okay. Next, I see a question is, what is the need or role of memory interface? You need really a memory interface basically because, see, memories are designed as standalone hips, right? So you need to be able to hook it up with the rest of your design. So definitely you will need some sort of an interface to actually connect with it, right? Regarding questions for the freshers, yeah. So basically, you would have realized that you typically need to understand the design a lot. So if you are looking to interview for the roles of memory, you have to be very good in your basics of CMOS. So typically, you will get some questions related to how the device behaviors are. how the inverters operate, what happens if you're sort of trying to invert. A very common question which gets asked is basically like, if you are trying to reverse the positions of the PMOS and NMOS in the inverter, what kind of situation does that give rise to, and things like that. And if you have a basic understanding of the memory bit cell and how it works, then it really helps. Okay. What is the basic skill set required for an engineer to get a job in SOC focused industry? So basic the skill sets that is basically required is at least an understanding of VLSI. Typically, so the memories basically come in something called backend, where you actually work a lot with devices and their layout. So you need to understand the VLSI, the fabrication technology, what happens with each of the layers, and some knowledge of device physics is extremely crucial, right? Next question is, DRC rules are violated in design process. Will there be any challenges because of it? See, the DRC rules are validated, are basically violated by someone who's actually fabricating. So I may actually, rephrase the question in this, right? Like, if something I'm designing by myself, I know I can violate something, and I know what violations are, and I can basically do my design based on that, right? So it is typically the case with that. And the violations are enabled just because you have, like a huge array of memory bit cells, a very repeatable structure. The violations are possible only when you are trying to fabricate a very repeatable structure, which the foundries use to basically come up with a denser memory arrays, right? We will address, there's an interference from the audience. Okay, then do we perform DFT for memories? How do you handle memory blocks for any DRC during DFT change? Okay, so DFTs are basically, built in the DFT circuit for memories. I'm not sure if you are going to handle DFTRC and DFT change stage. DRCs are handled on the design, right? When you are actually trying to get your physicals ready, you need to be ensured they're absolutely DRC clean, right? So the foundry, in along with the recipe for the fabrication, they are coded in something called a design rule manual, and then they also provide a DRC deck. After you are completed your designing and layouting of the memory, you need to actually basically run through the deck and ensure that there are no violations, right? Because those rules are actually coded by foundry in terms of a DRC deck, and you have to validate your design based on that deck and ensure that it comes all clean. Can you give some latest methods used for creating low power memories? Yeah, typically for going to low power memories, I mean, that is basically a topic in itself, right? So I'm not sure if I can actually cover all these here, but just to give you a flavor, typically there is a certain threshold voltage which is absolutely essential to be maintained across the memories for it to be able to operate or able to retain the data. And you can work pretty close to that by using something called assist techniques, right? So and that enables you to help design low power memory. So typically you can look up read and write assist and how they help in allowing the memories to operate pretty close to their retention voltage. What works have been done in memory computation, and what research is going on? Okay, so memory computation is an evolving topic. So maybe it might be a topic of interest in a future presentation. So just what I can say is that it's still an evolving topic, because you are trying to design, you have all heard about machine learning and artificial intelligence, and you're trying to come up with chips based on that, right? So folks are looking. I don't think there are solutions in the market, and maybe there might not be one solution that fits all, right? But yes, there has been some focus on those and looking at what you need to modify your bit cells to enable you to do that. What kind of circuit should be there in the control to enable that? So those things are being looked into, but I think it will be some time before we get to the solutions. Memory work with different clocks from cache to main memory. So does it stay synchronized for control signals, or should we use handshakes rather than single? See, again, I said that please don't look at memories in isolation. It all depends upon your applications, right? For example, someone might say, okay, my particular application can handle being simultaneously able to read and write. So I will basically design a memory using 80 bits, right? So it is all geared up your applications. Memories as in itself, there is nothing called a memory product, right? Memories are basically designed around your application. So your application will actually dictate what kind of memories are to be designed. Can you please suggest some more source on memory design and also prerequisite for getting a job in memory design? Yeah, as I said, right? So I think we already went over this question. There are many good books on memory design. So I don't remember something from the top of my head, but for digital design, definitely there is Rabe, which you actually go through, and you can definitely look over the net to come up across multiple books on VLSI design. So everything should have a chapter on memories. I'm extremely sorry, but I don't remember the name from the top of my head. And again, is it a prerequisite for getting a job in memory design? Yeah, you need to have a good understanding of the VLSI technology. You need to have a good understanding of device physics and certain and all the fundamental aspects of digital IC design. So these are the three important topics that need to you need to be thorough with to actually design the memories. Okay. I think we have run out of questions. Are there any more questions?
Okay. So guys, if any more question, let's wait for 2 minutes while you type it, and then we'll stop for today.
Can you please discuss the application of quantum computing in the field of VLSI? Okay. So, it's a little different. I mean, unrelated topic to this. So maybe, in some other presentation, we can actually cover that in future. Okay, so I guess we folks are done today. So I'm extremely sorry. I think there was some problem with my connection, so I'm not able to hear you folks in. But I hope you found the presentation useful, and hopefully should be able to use some of it to decide on what can be your career choices after graduating in VLSI. In VLSI field, right? So yeah. So thanks, guys. Oh yeah, if it's definitely possible. Okay. So yeah, we can see. If suppose someone is interested, maybe a later session we can conduct to cover a little bit more on details on that. But yeah, please let Trithiman know on that, and we'll see depending upon the availability. Okay. Okay, thanks guys, and wish you all a very bright future. Okay, bye.
Okay, thank you guys. I think unfortunately there is an audio issue, otherwise we would have taken it further. So we'll have our successive sessions in coming week, and stay connected on WhatsApp and follow our YouTube channel if you have not subscribed already. Thanks guys, bye.